Mark P. Otten, back with you.
Okay, so this is your one sample t-test lesson for Psych 320. We're going to start with the SPSS part of the example, and then we're going to move to the Excel and other sort of information there that I will show you to kind of support this idea that you can do a hypothesis test with one sample of information. And that information, that data, is based on a T distribution or a T curve as opposed to a normal curve or a Z curve. Those curves, the T curve and the normal curve, are very similar to each other, but I wanted to talk a little bit about what the differences are and why we use the T in this case. So all that is to come. I know you're excited. All right, so this is based on some past data from my 320 class. We can go ahead and recreate this experiment in class this year if we want. This is a bunch of ratings. These are, in particular, ratings of a song. So what I had was, has students in class rate a song on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being that they hated it and 10 being that they loved it. So there were a few 1s. There were also a few 10s. The song that I had them rate was the following. Okay, so that was, in case you didn't know, that was Closer by the Chainsmokers featuring Halsey, popular song. Anyway, so our class rated that song that year, and then what we can do is we can test a hypothesis. The hypothesis that we can test here is just a simple one, like, did our class like that song? If we put that in statement form, we might make a prediction, our class loves this song or likes this song, right? The alternative would then be that they don't like the song or they're indifferent. So we could test a hypothesis to put that into t-test terms. We would then state our null hypothesis as the mean for our class is equal to 5, let's say, because 5 is the middle. And the alternative hypothesis is that the mean for our class is not 5. Because if it's not 5, and if in fact it's greater than 5, then we can conclusively state that our class loved the song. Okay, so how do we do this? Well, I'm just going to run you through the SPSS first. We're going to go to Analyze, Compare Means, and a One Sample T-Test. Again, we have one column in SPSS. That's our one sample. We have one variable. That variable is continuous, so that's why we're testing it by way of a T. So if we click on that, we're going to move our rating variable over to the right. And it's tempting to just click OK, but the most important thing here, or the thing that is most often forgotten, is to change your test value. So I'm going to change your test value to 5, and that's based on your null hypothesis. So in advance, we stated our null hypothesis as the mean being 5, the alternative that it's not 5. And so if we were to leave it at 0, that would be another hypothesis test that would be SPSS would do it for us, but it would be the hypothesis that our mean is different than 0, which I'm sure it is because 0 wasn't even on the scale. The minimum was 1. So anyway, you switch your test value to 5, and you can go ahead and click through. Okay, so here's our output that we get. So it's just giving you two boxes here. The first box is a set of descriptive statistics, and the second box is the test itself. So the first box there clarifies your mean, 5.65 for 78 students, 2.80 standard deviation, and the standard error there, which will be useful for us in a little bit. So the mean 5.65 is greater than 5. Question was then, is it significantly greater than 5? And by this second box, we see our p-value 0.043, just barely below 0.05. So we can conclude to reject our null hypothesis. And yes, our mean is significantly different than 5. In fact, it's greater than 5. So your p-value is under the sig two-tailed column there. And the other information here that's important, in particular, your t under the t column here, is that's your t-test statistic, which we're going to calculate in Excel in a minute. The degrees of freedom there, 77, which I will also explain in this video what a degrees of freedom value really means. That, in this case, is n minus 1, 78 minus 1. And for our class purposes, you can ignore the confidence interval statistics there, although they do have meaning as well. So that's the SPSS for one sample t-test. Again, by the p-value less than 0.05, we reject our null hypothesis and conclude with the alternative, in fact, that our mean was different than 5 and our class enjoyed the song. Okay, so in Excel, I'm going to show you where that 2.059 for the test statistic came from. And then after that, we'll follow up with a little bit of meaning as far as what it really means, why the value means, or why the value exists for the test. So in Excel here, I've just lifted the mean 5.65 from SPSS. That was 78 people, so you could demonstrate how to calculate that mean, but it would take a while and sort of unnecessary. The population mean is the comparison value, the test value, which was 5. That was established in advance because our null hypothesis was that the mean is 5 and the alternative was that it was not 5. So ultimately we're going to compare those two values, but we got to compare them relative to the standard error, which is also there in SPSS, 0.31756, but I need you to know where that came from as well. So I'm going to give you that here. So I'm going to type in equals to tell Excel, hey, I'm about to calculate a formula, and then type in my standard deviation, 2.80457. Again, I've already asked you to calculate standard deviations in the past, so I wouldn't ask you to calculate it again here, certainly not for 78 people. So you can pull that from SPSS. But the standard error, once you have the standard deviation, is relatively easy to calculate. You divide the standard deviation by the square root of n, which is denoted in Excel by SQRT, parentheses, n. And then in this case, n is 78. So you can go ahead and type that in for this example. And that should give you your 0.31756 value. So again, it's a little bit off because of rounding there, but that's fine. So again, that standard error is your standard deviation divided by square root of n. That's always true for one sample. And then in the box for the t-test statistic, you're just going to take your sample mean, 5.65. I'll go ahead and not round as much. 5.6538 minus 5. That's the top part of the fraction. That's your comparison between your sample mean and your population mean, or the comparison between the sample mean and what is stated in your null hypothesis there, 5. So there's a difference there. That difference is then calculated relative to the standard error. So divided by A3 gives us divided by the cell in which the standard error is printed there, 0.3175, and then you get your test statistic, 2.059. So again, those numbers are a little bit off from SPSS just because I rounded slightly, but that's okay. So that's where that test statistic comes from. Okay, so then once we have the test statistic, we compare it to the critical value. This is the website that is on linked onto your Canvas page. This is the list of t-test statistic critical values, or t-test critical values. And so if we use 0.05, as we have done sort of as a standard decision there, as far as if the p-value is less than 0.05, reject the null hypothesis, we stick with that. We go to column 1 here, and we just try to find 77, which was our degrees of freedom, which is what SPSS gave us.
In fact, 77 is not present on this particular chart. It goes from 70 to 80, but if you go over to the 0.05 column there, you see that 70 is 1.994, 80 is 1.990. So once the degrees of freedom values get larger, you see the difference between the critical value from one to the next is very small. So for degrees of freedom 77, you can safely say 1.99 here.
So the 1.99 critical value gets compared back to this 2.06 test statistic, and since the test statistic is greater than the critical value, we reject our null hypothesis. Now, we already found our p-value to be less than 0.05, so again, this is the equivalent rule, right? If you have your p-value is less than 0.05, then your test statistic is going to be greater than your critical value by rule, and then also you reject your null hypothesis. Here it was pretty close, right? 2.06 was barely greater than 1.99, and the p-value was barely less than 0.05. Okay, so we have rejected our null hypothesis. We've successfully completed a one-sample t-test, but we use these sort of arbitrary seeming rules that we also, if you've watched the chi-square test video, for example, by now we use the same rules. That same rule is going to apply regardless. But what I'm going to try to do now is give you a little bit more context, because as we plow through all of the material, all of the different hypothesis tests in this class, this rule keeps coming back, and you deserve a little bit more information about what this means. So we've got, this is the other link that I've got posted on your Canvas page. This is kind of just for you to play around with. This is your t-distribution or t-curve interactive website. And it's not quite as fancy as the normal curve interactive website that I have up there, but it will show you the difference, or the regions under the curve that correspond to our different test statistic values and whatever values we want to plug in here for the t-distribution. So the t-distribution or the t-curve is the same shape as the normal curve. In fact, if the degrees of freedom goes on to infinity, or our sample size goes on to infinity, what does that mean? That means that our sample becomes our population, right? And if that's true, then the t-distribution or the t-curve becomes the normal curve. So the normal curve is like the t-curve with infinite degrees of freedom, or a gigantic sample. So we had a sample size for this particular example of 78 degrees of freedom, n minus 177. So that's big. And so when you see it on the chart here, it's going to look very much like the normal curve. If our degrees of freedom had been smaller, and you can actually set that up here. So if the degrees of freedom was 7, then it's going to be narrower. You see that? If it's 77 like it was for us, it's going to be fatter, and so on. So again, the same shape though, and the symmetry is there as far as the left side being equal to the right side. The ends of the curve go off toward the bottom there, but never quite touch the bottom technically, and so on. And its peak is in the middle. So what is this? How does this illustrate a hypothesis test? Well, the reason that we use a T curve instead of a Z curve is because we're using a sample instead of a population. So if we had the population, we would use a normal curve, because we would know that the population is normally is distributed normally, as they say. But we never have that in psychology research, or hardly ever. So we rely on samples, as I've indicated already in this class. So when we rely on samples, we use the t-curve, which is the sort of the sample version of the normal curve. And in the numbers, when we calculated the test statistic, we used the sample mean minus the population mean, which is a hypothetical value, divided by the standard error. And for the standard error, we used the sample standard deviation instead of a population standard deviation, if it were to exist. Typically, we don't have the population standard deviation, so we don't use the normal curve, and we use a t-curve. So we can then map out our numbers on the t-curve. This is the t-curve, then, is an approximation of what our data looks like. And in this particular example, it was a class of 78 people with a mean of 5.65, and the rating was of the song by the Chainsmokers featuring Halsey. Okay, so given that, you can imagine that the middle here, instead of at 0, is at 5.65, and some people like the song, so they're on the positive end of 0. Some people don't like the song, they're on the negative end of 0. So, but we need to convert our ratings to t-scores, and in this case we have an x here. The x is our 2.06, or 2.059, I think it was, for our test statistic. That falls in on the outside here. Okay, so what this region tells us, if it's a small region past this value here, as denoted on the curve, if it's small, then that means that our sample mean is indeed far away from our population mean. So you can imagine it either way. You can imagine it with the sample mean there at 0, or the population mean. So let's say the sample mean, like I said, is in the middle, 5.65 for this example. If 5 is far enough away from 5.65, then that cutoff value there on the graph, which you see there by the blue line, that line is going to be far enough away from 0, or the middle, to say, hey, there is a difference, there is a significant difference between these two values. And so what this curve does, if you select with this little drop-down menu here, the most useful one to select is going to be the third one. This is going to give you your p-value. It's at 2x probability. So what that means, it's going to give you some area on the right side in addition to some area on the left side, which is the best way to conceptualize a p-value. What this is doing is it's converting your test statistic to your p-value. And in this case, you can see it both ways. Then you can see the test statistic, and then you make your decision based on comparison of that to the critical value, which was seen over here in this chart. Or you see your test or you see your p-value here, which is 0.04288, less than 0.05, just by rule 0.05 you can use. And so then either way, you are establishing your decision, and you can see how the test statistic maps onto the p-value. So what does this mean on the graph? Well, you have your 2.059 on the positive side, 2.059 on the negative side, and the p-value is actually the area in, I guess that's pink, or lightish orange. That area is your p-value. That is the area beyond your test statistic. Let me show you what happens if the test statistic becomes closer to zero. So suppose the test statistic is like 0.5 or something like that. Then your cutoff point is much closer to zero. Your p-value is 0.6185. And what this scenario is suggesting is that your sample mean and your population mean are not at all different from each other, or certainly not enough to conclude any significant difference. And so that cutoff value then is closer to the middle, and the pink shaded area is larger. That's your p-value, clearly in this case greater than 0.05, and thus you're not rejecting your null hypothesis. So the area on this curve, above and below, or more extreme than your test statistic value, positive and negative, in this case it would be greater than 0.5 and less than negative 0.5. That is your p-value. In words, the p-value is the probability of the data given the null hypothesis is true. So in this case, if the null hypothesis is true, your mean of 5 is true. Our sample has a mean that is 5 or close to 5, right? If your p-value then is small, then the probability of the data given that the mean is 5 is small. Okay, so that was my attempt at showing you graphically why the p-value corresponds to the test statistic and vice versa, and why if the p-value is less than 0.05, you reject the null hypothesis just the same as if the test statistic is greater than the critical value. You reject the null hypothesis. The other thing that varies here, I think the take-home message is if that explanation didn't make sense, you can watch it over again. And if it still didn't make sense, you can come talk to me. If it clicks in, I think it's going to help you, because then you won't necessarily have to remember p less than 0.05. Just like memorize that, you'll actually have some concept of what it means, and then hopefully you can visualize the curve when you're trying to come up with this in your homework and on the test. But again, if it doesn't click in and you'd rather just memorize, go for it. Okay, so the other thing that varies here is the degrees of freedom value. So like I said earlier, you can make this a thinner or fatter curve depending on your degrees of freedom value. That's the curve for 7 degrees of freedom. This is the curve for, let's say, we'll see what 700 looks like. It's very fat. 77 is a little bit skinnier. Okay, so the idea with degrees of freedom is that in practice, when you have one sample, it's just n minus 1. So it's kind of just a substitute for sample size. The larger your sample size, the larger your degrees of freedom. But why is it n minus 1? Well, I'll offer a couple of thoughts on that here, and then we can see how it plays out in our future hypothesis tests. It's not always going to be n minus 1, but it's going to be sort of derived from this. So the idea with the degrees of freedom, so freedom implies that a value is free to be anything. So suppose you have, let's say, 4 numbers, and you want the mean has to be equal to 16. Now you could have the standard deviation has to be equal to 17 or whatever. There's some statistic about those 4 numbers that is fixed. So suppose the mean has to be 16 and you have the 4 numbers. Well, you go ahead and you choose the 4 numbers. The first number can be anything. Let's say 16. The second number can be anything. Let's say 18. The third number can be anything. Let's say 14, right? those numbers are free to be anything. But then when you get to the fourth number, if you already know your first three numbers are 16, 18, and 14, and you know that the mean has to be 16, then that fourth number has to be 16, right? So that fourth number, I mean, it doesn't necessarily have to be 16 every time. Like, suppose we select three different numbers, right? We select 47 and 38 and 4. Those are our first three numbers. Whatever they are, if we know the mean has to be X, if the mean has to be 16, then that fourth number is not free. Therefore, you have 1, 2, 3 free numbers and one not free number. And so your degrees of freedom are 3 for a sample of 4. If you have a sample of 7, your degrees of freedom for picking numbers, you can pick anything all the way up to 6, but then that 7th number has to be a specific thing, and so it's not free. And so it comes to n minus 1 regardless of what sample size you have. So that's my, again, that one may have just flown right by you. Luckily you have the rewind button if you want to try to understand a little bit more about degrees of freedom. You can listen to me again, or you can take some notes while I go through that on the video. So hopefully that makes some sense as far as what the term means, at least, degrees of freedom, and why with one sample it's always n minus 1. Once we get into multiple samples, I'll give you a hint. For example, if you have 2 samples, the degrees of freedom is going to be n minus 1 plus n minus 1, and so on. So anyway, it'll vary a little bit based on which hypothesis test we're running and what our data looks like, but that's your initial explanation for degrees of freedom, to go along with your initial explanation for what the p-value and the test statistic look like on the graph.
Okay, so there's one more thing I want to do, and that is introduce you to something called effect size, which is supplemental to a hypothesis test and supplemental to a test statistic. The first one here is called Cohen's D.
So Cohen's D is your effect size for a one sample t-test, and then there will be other measures of effect size for the other tests that we run in the class. This one is the top part of the fraction for Cohen's D is the same as it is for the test statistic for a t-test, and that is a sample mean minus a population mean. So if you're watching this as a continuation of our video on that was based on class ratings of the song Closer by the Chainsmokers featuring Halsey, then you may notice that the top part of the fraction here is the same. That's a 5.8 minus 5, basically, are your numbers there. For the test statistic, however, you have a standard error on the bottom. Here you have a standard deviation on the bottom. And this is not a test statistic. It is not then compared to anything. A critical value, for example, is not compared to Cohen's D. Cohen's D is just a measure that stands alone. By dividing by the standard deviation, you're putting this in standard deviation units. So if you get like a 0.5, that's a 0.5 standard deviations. For you guys in your homework, you're just reporting this value and you're calling it good. In real life, you report this value and you make a little bit of a claim based on it. This is not a value to reject or not reject your null hypothesis. This is supplemental. So some see it as unnecessary, but it is not. It is actually very helpful to report an effect size in addition to your hypothesis testing result. And for Cohen's D on a one sample test, 0.8 is considered a large effect. 0.8 or greater. Anything smaller than that is either small or medium effect. But those are guidelines. Those aren't particular rules. And just as a follow-up to the effect size introduction here, I just wanted to show you. So who is this Cohen? Well, this is Jacob Cohen, who is a statistician, and he was at NYU, New York University, for many, many years. Working as a statistician. He named the statistic after himself, as many statisticians have done over the years. And he was a critic of using the p-value, an early critic of using the p-value exclusively, or the test statistic, exclusively to evaluate hypothesis tests. And this is actually a relevant topic. It was relevant for him in 1950, and it's relevant for us now because this whole criteria of you reject your null hypothesis if the p-value is less than 0.05, it's sort of arbitrary. It goes back to Ronald Fisher, 1920, just sort of deciding that, well, I'm 95% confident, so 5% of the time I'm going to make an error. Oh, well. Well, the idea of that is fine, and it's supported scientific research for many years. But in short, it's a little bit problematic because you will get results sometimes. Like, suppose you have this amazing finding, and you conclude with 95% confidence, a p-value less than 0.05, that it exists, or this finding exists. And then you're unable to go and do it again. Like you try on a new sample of people and that effect goes away or it's not there anymore. Well, that means you're unable to replicate your finding, repeat it on a new sample. And so maybe you actually made an error in the original experiment, and maybe it's not actually there and science is advancing based on this amazing finding of yours, but it's actually not a finding at all. It's just a 5% of the time you're going to make an error. So what effect size does is it kind of gets around that, and it allows you to, and as we'll see more and more as we go along through our hypothesis test, it allows you to compare your result to other studies' results, because an effect size is not a decision, it's just a statistic. It's like a descriptive statistic of your hypothesis test that will allow a researcher to be a little bit more, think a little bit more critically. It's like, well, yes, we rejected our null hypothesis, but the effect size was only 0.15, so maybe this is not that big a deal after all. Or we didn't reject our null hypothesis, but the effect size is like 1.3. Whoa, maybe this is something after all. So the effect size allows for an additional objective criteria to evaluate our test. But for you guys, again, in the homework, that was probably too much information. Really, you just need to do your hypothesis test and report the effect size and leave it at that. Speaking of too much information, the first time I saw Jacob Cohen, I was like, why do I recognize that name? And then I realized that this famous comedian here, Rodney Dangerfield, who was also in a number of movies, including Caddyshack, Easy Money, some 1980s films, his birth name was Jacob Cohen. And that's all I'm going to say about that. So that's why I got confused. But anyway, enough about Rodney Dangerfield. Jacob Cohen is the Cohen that we're talking about when we report Cohen's D for our homework.